Welcome to week 4. So in this week, we will be looking into the design of control unit. So till now, what we have seen? We have seen that how an instruction gets executed. What are the hardware blocks that are required for that execution of the instruction? And for executing that instruction, basically some steps are required. That we are saying that the piece content of the PC will go to MAR, and then that particular content in MAR will hit the memory that through the address bus, and then we will get the data, and then something else will happen. So for any instruction, certain steps are required to be executed, and for executing those steps, we require some hardwares like the registers, the ALU and other interconnecting block, other register, IR, PC and all other. So in this particular design of control unit, we will be seeing that what are the signals that needs to get generated for executing an instruction. So we will be seeing this in course of these 6 lectures that are there in week 4. So this we already know that instructions are stored in main memory. So program counter points to the next instruction. So here we have an instruction. Next, the PC points to this location, it points to the next instruction, then the next one, then the next one. So each time an instruction is fetched, the PC gets incremented to the next one, such that once the execution of this particular instruction is completed, the next instruction can be fetched, and again the PC gets incremented, and so on. Generally, MIPS instructions are all 4 bytes, 32 bits long. All instructions starts from an address, that is the multiple of 4. Last 2 bits will be 0. And normally the PC gets incremented by 4 to point to the next instruction. We know about this particular thing from the very beginning. Let us recall this as well. In binary number system, we have 2 digits, 0 and 1. This is how it is represented, both in this and in decimal. Addressing a byte in memory, we know that memory is byte addressable. So each byte in a memory has a unique address, not each bit, rather each byte. So typically the instruction are of 4 bytes. Hence, the instruction memory addressed in terms of 4 bytes, that is word length is 32 bits. When an instruction is executed, PC is incremented by 4, if it is 4 byte. What if it is 64, if it is 8 byte, it will be incremented by 8 and so on. So, to point to the next instruction. Now, let us see how an instruction gets executed. So, what happens? This is memory. So, from the memory, all the instruction and data are loaded here. We fetch the instruction. After we fetch the instruction, we decode that particular instruction. After decoding, whatever necessary thing needs to be done for that instruction, maybe add, maybe branch, maybe whatever is performed. That is, we execute that particular instruction, and then we move on to the next one, the value pointed by PC, and again we do the same thing. Again we fetch, we decode and we execute. So this is the fetch execute cycle. Fetch the next instruction from memory, decode the instruction and execute the instruction. In the execution process, what we do? It might happen, we have various kinds of instruction. Let us say, we can have an instruction which is add, R1 comma R2. We can also have an instruction called add R1 comma LOC A. In this particular case, we can say the operands are present in the processor register as well. In this case, we need to bring a data from memory and then we can process this data. So, in this case, no further memory access will be required, but for this particular case, further memory access will be required. So, in the execution cycle, once we decode the instruction and we know that, okay, this is the addressing mode and so on and so forth, now we need to execute it. So, we get the data from memory if needed, data not available in the processor, perform the required operation on data, we perform that required operation that is required for the data, may also store the result back in memory or in register as and when it is required. So, in these two particular cases, we need not have to store back in memory, but in this particular case, it might happen, we need to store the result back in memory. So, we first fetch this instruction, then we fetch this particular data, then we perform the operation and finally, we store back again in this particular memory location. So, this is the fetch execute cycle. The register we already know about IR and PC. This is the instruction register and this is PC, program counter. Program counter holds the address of the memory location containing the next instruction to be executed. Instruction register contains the current instruction being executed. So, if this is my current instruction, then PC and this value is 2000, it will have, the PC will have 2000. Next, the PC will get incremented and it will have 2004 and so on. So, the PC will point to the next instruction. Once we fetch this instruction, IR will contain this particular instruction. So, instruction register contains the current instruction being executed. Basic processing cycle to be implemented is after PC points to the memory location where it is. So, memory location of the PC will be transferred to IR. Now, my IR contains the instruction, current instruction. Considering the word length of the machine is 32 bit, the PC is incremented by 4 to point to the next location. Now, PC will have PC plus 4. Then we carry out the operation specified in IR. So, whatever is specified in IR, we decode that and we perform the specific operation. Let us take an example. Add R1 comma R2 mul R3 comma R4. So, PC initially contains 1000, MAR contain 1000, PC now contains 1004, MDR will contain add R1 comma R2, this entire instruction, IR will also contain this instruction. Finally, it will get decoded and executed and then after adding these two, the result is stored back in R1. Now, you see, these are some steps that are happening. We can see this in terms of some values because we know that, okay, this particular address is having this value. Now, it will go to MAR. But if we require our computer to do this, some signals needs to be generated at proper sequence to perform this particular operation, depending on certain hardware that is present. So, what is the requirement for instruction execution? The necessary registers must be present. We need to have the registers for that operation. Internal organization of the registers must be known. This is very important and this is what we will be looking into in this particular lecture, that internal organization of the register. What do you mean by internal organization? I say that you will be having registers. You will be having an ALU, you will be having other register, you have your PC, MAR, MDR, all these register. How these are connected? We need to know that. And if we want to know that how these are connected, we also need to know that internally how it is connected, because in turn MDR and MAR is connected to the memory bus, but we need to know the internal structure of the organization of the hardwares, such that we must know that how the registers are connected, how the ALU is connected. To perform an operation in ALU, what needs to be brought in, how it should be brought in, and everything. So, we need to know the complete idea, a complete picture of what is there inside. So, the internal organization of the registers must be known, the data path must be known, that is, we will be seeing what is data path. So, for instruction execution, a number of micro operations are carried out on the data path, may involve movement of data. That means, when we are performing add R1 comma R2, this particular instruction, how this data is actually moving, how from R1 there is a some value will be there in R1, how it is coming to the ALU, how R2 is coming to the ALU, and how finally you are adding it and finally storing back the result in R1. So, all these operation, how it is happening, we need to know. So, the steps that are required for execution is known as some micro operation. Some micro operation should be carried out on the data path provided. So, let us see the kinds of data movement. Broadly, it can be registered to register, it can be registered to ALU, or ALU to register. We will be seeing all these kind of transfer in course of time. So, the data movement is supported by the data path, and the data path contains what? The registers, the bus through which the data will move, the ALU, and of course, some of the temporary registers. Some temporary registers are needed for this. So, all these together is supported in the data path. Coming to the single bus organization. So, this is a very simple single bus organization that we are showing, which is internal to the processor bus. And now see, these are the buses, this is the data bus and this is the address bus, which is connected to the memory through these two registers, MAR and MDR. So, we see that internal processor bus. In this internal processor bus, we have PC, which can go. So, data from this bus can come in here, and from PC also the data can be available in this bus. We have MAR, memory address register, which we can see that from this bus only data can go to MAR. We have memory data register. So, of course, this line is missing. So, there will be a connection between internal processor bus as well, and then this connection will be there. So, internal processor bus, this will also be a two-way connection. So, a two-way connection will be there. So, data from this bus can also come into MDR, and from MDR also the data can come into this processor bus. Now, you see this ALU. This ALU performs the required operation. And there are two inputs of the ALU and one output. We see that one input of the ALU is directly coming from the bus. So, whatever data is there in the bus can be directly connected to this input of the bus. If we say this is A input and this is B input, in this B input we can say that it is available. And another data is coming through this Y register. YZ is a temporary register. So, Y register, how it is coming? Y from this, it is coming to Y. And from Y, there is a MUX. Now, see that MUX is selecting either the output of Y or it is selecting this 4. Why this 4 is required, we will be seeing little later, but let us understand for the moment that when this select line is 1, either we select 4, if the select line is 0, either we select y, depending on how you have implemented it. So, at a time either 4 comes into ALU or at a time y comes into ALU. After any particular function that is performed by ALU, then the data is transferred to Z register. And from the Z register, the data can be available in the internal processor bus. And from this internal processor bus, now the data can move to any of these registers. So, these are nothing but the general purpose register that are available. This is the IR and this is the instruction decoding and control unit. Instruction decoding and control unit is required to generate the control signals. So, ultimately this unit will be generating the control signals necessary to execute an instruction. So, this is a single internal bus organization. So, let us see some of the features that I already discussed. This is the single internal bus organization. All the registers and various units are connected using a single internal bus. Understand, we have only one bus through which it is connected. Registers are 0 to Rn minus 1. So, we have n general purpose registers used for various purposes. So, these are used for various purposes. Y and Z are used for storing intermediate result. So, the intermediate result of any operation is stored in these registers and they are never used by an instruction explicitly, meaning we will never see that we are doing something like add R1 comma Y. We will never do that. We in the instruction we will only have add R1 comma R2 etc., which is the general purpose register or the location. But this is internally used, not explicitly by an instruction. The multiplexer selects either a constant 4 or the output of register Y. Either we select 4 or the output of Y is selected. When PC is incremented, a constant 4 has to be added. Now understand this. What happens when we say that this is my PC. PC is now 1000. Now, the PC needs to get incremented. So, you have to do 1000, that is PC plus 4. How will you do this? We cannot simply do this. We need a circuit to do this. And for doing this, this input must come into one of the input of ALU and this input must come in one of the input of ALU. So, if it comes to any one input of the ALU, then we can add 1000 plus 4 and then the result can be stored in Z and from Z it can be again put it in PC. So, it becomes 1004 again. So, this is how it can be done. So, when PC is incremented, a constant 4 has to be added. The instruction decoder and control unit is responsible for performing the action specified by the instruction loaded into IR. Now, once the instruction is fetched from the memory, it comes through MDR and then it goes to IR using that single bus. Once it is loaded in IR, now it is the responsibility of the decoder unit to decode that particular instruction and then it generates whatever needs to be done. If it has to bring the data from memory again, it will do the required operation. If the data is already present in the processor register, then it has to add it or multiply it or whatever action is specified it needs to be done. So, The instruction decoder, the control unit, is responsible for performing the action specified by the instruction loaded into IR. The decoder generates all the control signals in proper sequence required to execute the instruction specified by IR. Now, the decoder decodes the instruction. After decoding the instruction, it generates the control signals that are required for that particular instruction in a proper sequence. Now, what is data path then? The registers, the ALU, and the interconnecting bus are collectively referred to as the data path. That means through this particular path, the data is moving for performing the operation. So, for performing the operation, it has to come to ALU, then from ALU it has to again go to some register. So, how it is going? The registers are involved, the ALU is involved, and the connecting bus through which the data is moving. So, data is moving through all these places. Collectively, this is referred to as data path. So, now let us see what are the kinds of operations that are performed. Transfer of data from one register to another, let us say moving a data from R2 to R1, it is required. Perform arithmetic or logic operation on data loaded into register. Let us say the data is loaded in R1 and R2, all we need to do is that we perform certain operation and store it back here. So, here also this is a kind of operation which is required. Fetch the content of memory location and load it into register, basically load. So, we are loading a data from this memory location and we are storing it in R1, or store a word of data from a register into the memory location. So, we are storing a word that is R1 with whatever value is stored in R1 into LOCA, a memory location. So, this is for load, this is for store. So, these are the various kinds of operation that we can have. Let us come to three bus organization. Now, in the previous case, you have seen a single internal bus organization. And in that single internal bus organization, we will be seeing in later lectures that only at a time a particular value can be available in the bus, and that particular value can go to any number of registers, but at a time only one data can be available in that bus. If we want to make more data available, then what we need to do? One possible way of doing so is having multiple bus structure. So, what happens in multiple bus architecture? In multiple bus architecture, we have multiple internal buses inside a processor. The MDR and MAR will be connected to the same system bus, but internally we will not have a single bus. We will see that a single bus will restrict some operation to be done parallelly. If we want to perform some operation to be done parallelly, we require multiple bus architecture. So, in multiple bus organization, we can see we will see a typical three bus architecture for a processor data path, which is shown in the next slide. So, these are just some of the features. A three bus organization is internal to the CPU. As I said, we will be looking into a bus organization which is internal to the CPU. We have already seen a bus organization which is a single bus organization. Now, we will be seeing a three bus organization. The three buses allows three parallel data transfer operation to be carried out. Less number of cycles in turn will be required to execute an instruction compared to single bus organization. We will be looking into this with examples later. Now, let us see this particular multi bus organization, which is a three bus organization. So, in this three bus organization, let us see what we have. This is a register file. In this register file, using VLSI technology, what we can do is that we can read multiple data, but we can write only one data into the register file. So, two registers can be read at a time because we have two buses and the data from these register file is going to two different bus. But write can happen only once and it is coming also from a different bus. PC is incremented by a different circuitry. That is an incrementer circuit is present where PC will get incremented by 4. Now, this is the ALU. The input of ALU is coming from two different bus. One is from bus A, another is from bus B. So, what advantage can we get here? What advantage we can get here is that we can make available the data of R1 and R2 here. And if we perform that operation and both R1 and R2 can be present at the same time and we can also perform this add operation and we can also store back here at the same time. But in a single bus organization, only one out can be made possible at a time. One particular data will be available in the bus at a time. As it is having, there is multiple buses, multiple data can be available. This is an instruction decoder. So, after from MDR, the data will be available and then this particular data will be moved to IR and the instruction decoder will decode the instruction and specified operation will be carried out. MAR and MDR is connected to the address and data bus of the memory as well. So, this is a three bus organization. We have seen single bus organization, we have seen multiple bus organization. We will be seeing in detail what is the advantage you will be understanding in course of time when we execute a particular instruction using these bus structure, these bus organization. So, now we have come to the end of this lecture where we have discussed about the overall internal bus organization, how internally within the CPU the bus is organized. Thank you.